Hey, Canucks fans, let's talk about the bottom six. By my count, there are 9 players vying for 6 spots. I'm Clay Emo. I'm at Canuck Clay on Twitter. I'm at Clayton Emo on Instagram. I'm the founder of the GLCPC, the Good Looking Canucks Positivity Club. And this is my Canucks take, all in one take. It's Clay's Canucks commentary for Monday, July the 20th. This is where you get Canucks insight that's positive and timely. Thanks to everyone who joined me for my live stream last night. We had a lot of fun. I started a few minutes late, but for good reason. I was busy securing my next guest for my Zoom chat series. And I'm proud to announce that that will indeed be Dan Murphy of Sportsnet 650. I'll be interviewing him actually later today at the end of my workday and having that vlog up tomorrow morning. So messaging back and forth with him just before I was supposed to start my live stream. But I came on a few minutes late and apologized, but for good reason. So look forward to my chat with Dan Murphy tomorrow morning. One thing we talked about the live stream yesterday was the scrimmage. The scrimmage that the Canucks held last night. It was broadcast live, audio only on Instagram, so that was interesting. But it worked. Brendan Batchelor did a great job. And Zack MacEwen had another great, strong performance. And I think the two things that really come out that really spurred my, inspired me, the today's topic, was the performance of Zack MacEwen and the return of Micheal Ferland. Zack MacEwen had a goal, again, looked like one of the dominant players on the ice. And then as for Micheal Ferland, his first time skating, he made it through the entire scrimmage, 50 minutes. Of course, he wasn't skating the whole 50 minutes, but he took a regular shift, some of the shifts a little shorter than others, but still, it was good to see him get through an entire contest, even though it was more of a scrimmage as opposed to a full-fledged game. But in the Canucks highlight package, they released, and I kind of joked about it a little bit. On one play, they showed whistle going, and then Ferland riding Hughes into the boards behind the net. It wasn't a dirty hit. It wasn't a hard hit. He was barely checking him. But I did make the point of, I said, it's glad to see Micheal Ferland getting engaged again. I just wish it wasn't with Quinn Hughes. But obviously, Ferland's doing his best to get back into game shape as well. And with him, it was good to see, because Ian McIntyre wrote a really good story yesterday on Ferland's vestibular system. And basically, it's the inner ear sensory system that's throwing off a bit of his balance and his peripheral vision, his spatial awareness, and all those things. And obviously resulting from his concussion history. So it was great to see Ferland on the ice. So with Zack MacEwen's, continuing to play a prominent role, basically, at least last night, unseating Jake Virtanen for the right wing spot in the third line. With Ferland's return, and even though Brandon Sutter didn't play, but I'm going to talk about it here, I'd say there are 9 guys vying for 6 spots. We know who the top 6 are, but when it comes to the bottom 6, there are 9 forwards that are trying for those 6 spots. And then I saw Thomas Drantz write earlier that really he thinks it's actually only 5 forwards down for 2 spots, i.e. 4 of them are locks. So if we presume that Gaudet and Roussel are locks on that third line, and that Beagle and Mott are locks on that fourth line, then you already have Beagle, Mott, Roussel as penalty killer. So you probably need one more penalty killer among the 2 remaining right wing spots. So, the 5 guys that Thomas Drantz mentioned that are vying for those 2 spots, I gotta start using that word vying. I gotta think of a different word. But it's MacEwen, it's Virtanen, it's Erickson, it's Sutter, and it's Ferland. So again, MacEwen, Virtanen, Sutter, Erickson, Ferland, and then you add Roussel, Gaudet, Beagle, and Mott. Those are my 9 guys trying to snag one of those 6 spots. So if we agree with Thomas Drantz's assertion that Roussel, Gaudet, and Beagle and Mott are locks, and I would agree with that, because all good defensively, you need Adam Gaudet as a center, you need Beagle as center, they got to be able to take draws. Then, so let's say those 4 guys are indeed in. So it's the other 5 guys we should talk about really quickly. Micheal Ferland, I think it would be kind of risky to ask him to play a full game at full contact, especially if he's not going to get a chance to do that. Maybe they'll play him in the exhibition game, but I'm not sure if he would be a leading candidate for one of those 2 spots left. Louis Erickson, obviously a veteran, he can kill penalties. Doesn't matter what his salary is at this point. It's a matter of, can he bring a lot to your lineup? And I said, yeah, he brings some veteran presence as well. So Erickson might be good. Then you're looking at MacEwen versus Virtanen. It looks like, as of now, MacEwen has unseated Virtanen as the preferred third line option. And if MacEwen continues to play well and be very noticeable, much more noticeable than Jake in the scrimmages, then maybe MacEwen has a leg up on him. And then Brandon Sutter's the wild card from a standpoint of, he wasn't at practice yesterday. declared unfit to play, right? That's the NHL's terminology for this postseason. So we don't know if it's a serious injury, a tweak, whether it's his groin or, you know, he's had groin problems before or some or somewhere else in his body. It could be serious. It could be not serious. It could be COVID related. It could be testing related. We just don't know. And that's the nature of the NHL right now. But with Brandon Sutter, you also have someone who's defensively responsible and can take draws as well. So it's going to be fascinating to watch. I think if I had to handicap him, I think MacEwen gets in. So he'll be playing with Gaudette and Roussel. And then on your fourth line, I think if Sutter is healthy, I would go with him. And then Erickson would draw in if Sutter wasn't healthy. So that would mean that it's Jake Virtanen and Micheal Ferland on the outside looking in. And, you know, they're similar players. I keep talking about how I want Jake Virtanen to play as well as Micheal Ferland did 5 years ago in that Calgary series, because they both can have a huge impact if they're playing well and if they're on the top of their game. So we still have more time to figure this out. There's still another week of training camp, preseason, training camp and scrimmages heading up to preseason, right? Heading up to their first game against Winnipeg on Wednesday the 29th. And then of course, starting off against Minnesota on August the 2nd. So to back it up, the Canucks will practice this week. They'll travel to Edmonton on Sunday, then prepare for their exhibition game on Wednesday against Winnipeg, and then they start their play-in series against Minnesota on Sunday. So the question for today is, who's going to make up our bottom six? If I had to guess, I'd say you have a third line of Gaudette, Roussel, MacEwen, and a fourth line of Beagle, Mott, and Sutter if he's healthy, and Erickson if Sutter cannot play. So there we go. So question of the day for you, Canucks fans, is what would your bottom six look like? We'd love to know your thoughts. Leave a comment below. Tell me who your bottom six would be and who would be playing with who and who would be your first guy off the bench, so to speak. Leave a comment. I will read, react, and reply as always. Subscribe if you like to. Like this video if you like to. Look forward to my chat with Dan Murphy tomorrow right here on this YouTube channel. Stay safe. Stay healthy. Take care of yourselves. Take care of each other. Have a great day. God bless. And go Canucks, go.